will be Sunday, my Lord.
Amen, amen. When we walk around heaven, no one will be able to put us out. We will be there to sing and shout. Amen. Good morning, good morning. Bid you welcome to the St. James Cumberland Presbyterian Church in America, our live stream of our Sunday school on today, the first Sunday in January of the year 2021. I am your teacher, Elder Stephen Thomas, and again, we really bid you welcome for joining us on today as we open up a brand new year, as the Lord has saw fit to allow us to journey into 2021. We thank him for his grace and his mercy, because it was not something that we did. We didn't keep his commandments so well that we are afforded this opportunity for our days to roll on a little while longer. Amen. As we go into our lesson, and we again thank you all for tuning in with us, we bid you welcome wherever you are, members and friends here in Decatur, Alabama, the state of Alabama, the United States of America, or wherever you are on the planet. We bid you a hearty welcome for tuning in with us. As we prepare to go into our Sunday school lesson on today, the first Sunday in January of 2021, January 3rd, we petition the Lord to lead and guide us and to help us to understand his word, help us to be able to rightly divide his word and to share his word with his people. May we pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, again, we thank you. God, we thank you for being God all by yourself. God, thank you for being so merciful and kind and allowing our days to roll on a little while longer. God, we thank you for allowing us to be able to get into 2021. God, we know that there were so many things that occurred in 2020, and Lord, you being again so kind and so wonderful, Lord, you allowed us to see this day, a day that was not promised to us, but God, a day that you saw fit to allow us to be a part of it. And God, as we are preparing to go into your word, God, we ask that you please lead and guide us down through the treasures of your word. God, help us to get what we will need out of your word so that we can stay on a straight and narrow pathway that leads to everlasting life. God, we have some sick among us. God, we don't have to call out their names because, God, you know everything. Lord, your word teaches us that not even a sparrow goes beneath your notice. And so, God, we're asking you to please comfort and touch and heal as only you can. God, we have some bereavement among us. God, we call the roll, and Lord, there were many of our members who passed on. And God, we bless and ask you to please continue to look over their families, Lord. Touch and heal as only you can, and comfort, Lord. And Lord, as we are here and going into your word, we ask that you please lead and guide us and teach us. Lord, this and many of the blessings we ask in your Son, Jesus the Christ's name. Amen. As we are preparing to go into the word, our lesson today, the title of our lesson is Called to Proclaim. Called to Proclaim. Our Bible background is Luke chapter 4. The aim for change for this lesson is, by the end of this lesson, we will comprehend the meaning and significance of Jesus' inaugural sermon in Nazareth. Since the impact of Jesus' announcement at Nazareth, and align our faith response with Jesus' call and mission. I will keep in mind, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And that is from Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, 18 through 19. As we're going into our lesson, this is the gospel according to the great physician Luke. And as we are going into this lesson, in chapter 3, John had baptized Jesus, and Jesus had gone into the wilderness. And while being in the wilderness, he was tempted for 40 days, tempted by the devil. And that tempted means that he was being tested by the devil. We understand that, as Luke had written there in the first part of chapter 4, that Satan came and Jesus was there for 40 days and he was hungry, and Satan asked him if you be the Son of God, Satan knowing who Jesus is, and asked him to command these stones that they be made bread. And Jesus said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And Satan came with two other attacks, and with each one of those attacks, the Lord used the Bible to share what God had said, and he used the quotes from the Old Testament, which lets us know that the Old Testament and the New Testament, those are the inspired words of God, because Jesus used them to ward off the devil. And after the devil then left Jesus for a season, and for the season meaning for left him for at that time, but we know he came back again to try to get our Lord and Savior to change, because we know that when after Peter had made the great declaration that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, then Jesus said that he would have to go away. And Peter came and immediately and said that, no, don't let that happen, not so. And Jesus then told him, get thee behind me, Satan. So we know Satan was always trying to stop our Lord and Savior from trying to do the mission that he was called to do. And Jesus is going to go into that mission on our lesson today. So as we look at our lesson today, with the gospel according to Luke chapter 4, let us take the first three verses there and go from verse chapter 4 of Luke, but we're going to start at verse number 14. We'll do 14 through 16 in those three verses there. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified of all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. As we are looking, Jesus, after going through and fasting for 40 days there in the wilderness, after warding off and beating off the devil who's coming to try to tempt him and to test him, the Lord came, and verse 14 says, and Jesus returned after being in the wilderness. He returned. And where did he return? He returned in the power of the Spirit. And notice, this Spirit is a capital S. This is return in the power of the Holy Spirit. And he returned with the power of the Holy Spirit into Galilee. Galilee is that region there where Nazareth was a city in the region, but he returned to that region of Galilee and with the full power of the Holy Spirit. And this is letting us know that God the Father, God the Son are all together, and Jesus, dependent of the Holy Spirit there, is with him. And so he returned with the power of the Spirit into Galilee by walking and going and sharing with the full power, and him being God in the flesh. It goes and it says, and there went out a fame of him. We know that fame is when people are talking about you. You can be famous for something positive, you can be famous for something negative, but Jesus is famous here for his power. He's famous here because he is God's Son. He's famous here because he's being endued with power from on high. He has the Holy Spirit on him, and he is there and sharing. And the fame about the miracles that he is doing, the teachings that he's doing, he's becoming famous about that. And that fame about him throughout all the region round about.
Everyone was talking about this man named Jesus who's coming and he is breaking down the bread of life. He is sharing God's word. He is interpreting the commandments and he's interpreting God's word and he is keeping the commandments. He's doing everything that is positive. And so with verse 14, it shares that by the power of the Holy Spirit, the fame is getting out that people are starting to talk and understand about Jesus. And verse 15 says, what the mission that he was doing. He came and he taught. He taught the people in their synagogues. That we know that a synagogue, that we know that they had the temple there in Jerusalem, but they also had synagogues where they would be able to assemble and to worship. But you would need to have at least 10 Jewish men for a synagogue to be set up. And so Jesus went round about going to the people, going to them and teaching them God's word, teaching and sharing because he is the author of the word. We know that Jesus makes up part of the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. So he is able to go and teach with authority and teach with the right dividing of the word. So he's going around to the people, meeting them where they are, meeting them in the synagogues and teaching them. And when he was teaching them, he was glorified of all. The people were there and able to witness his teaching and able to understand his teaching. And they then are accepting it and they follow what Jesus is interpreting and rightly interpreting God's word. Verse 16 says, and he came to Nazareth, as I shared. He was in Galilee, which was a region, and Nazareth is a city within the region. So he returned to his hometown, because it says, and he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up. We know that we would call that today our hometown. We all have a hometown where we were born and raised, where we grew up, where everyone may know us and know all the things about us. For when we're young, as we're growing older, they then see and know a lot of things about us. Now, as we're talking about growing up and growing older here, Jesus is the age of 30 years old. Jesus, and the age of 30 is very significant because that is the age that a priest will start doing their priestly duties. And so Jesus is now taking on the role of priest. He's going on to do the things. And so as we're looking here in 16, he's there in Nazareth, the city where he was brought up, and it says, and as his custom was. A custom is a thing that you always do. It's something that we continuously do. Some people have a custom of coming to church every Sunday. Amen. Some have a custom of coming every other Sunday. Some have a custom of coming just on the special days. And some have a custom of not going at all. But our Lord and Savior has a custom of going to the synagogue on the Sabbath. Now, Jesus being raised as a Jew, he would do all the things that was required and do all the things because he is serving God the Father. And so as we look, it says here that as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. God had given us, and he said, 6 days we shall work, but on the Sabbath, keep it holy. The Sabbath day was made for man so that we would have an opportunity to go and to worship and serve our Lord. And so Jesus then, as was his custom, went to the synagogue on the Sabbath, and he stood up for to read. Jesus is going to stand up to read from the Old Testament and read some of the words of the prophet, and that's where he is doing, and that is what he is doing now. He's reading, he is prepared to read. And this gives us the first inclination as far as how the worship services were performed for the Jewish people in their synagogues. We understand that there was prayer, sometimes loud prayer, sometimes silent prayers, also teachings. And if someone was there who was able to give a sermon, then someone would give a sermon which would be expounding on the word, where they would go in and explain what was being said or what the prophet had said. As we now look at the next few verses here, we're going to go from chapter 4 of Luke, from verse number 17 down through verse number 20. Jesus is going to read part of the Bible, part of the Old Testament. And as he's reading this, he's going to share some things with the people. And so as we look at verse 17 says, And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." Verse 20, "And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him." Jesus stood up to read, as was his custom. They were very familiar with Jesus reading the Bible, the scriptures. They were very familiar with him because this is his hometown. He grew up there in that city. They are knowledgeable about him. They can even recall maybe back when he was a lad of 12 years old, that when they all went to Jerusalem and when everybody came back, Jesus was not among them. But he remained there in the city, and when his parents found him, they found him in the temple asking questions and answering questions of the doctors and the lawyers, and he was just a child of 12 years old. And so they then maybe can remember or have an understanding that Jesus knows a lot about the Bible because he is part of the Godhead that wrote the Bible. So as we are looking here at verse number 17, it says that when they gave him the scrolls, and these books here were not books as we have them that are opened up with pages, but they were scrolls. And so verse 17 says, "And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah, and when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written." So they are familiar with the scrolls. The scrolls have been written down. And so they finding what the Old Testament said, what did the prophet Isaiah say? And verse number 18 says, Jesus reading to the people that are there in the synagogue. Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, and he has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." As Jesus is reading this, he is telling them, and we see the Spirit is the Spirit with a capital S. And Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." Jesus, as we read in verse 14, we talked about that when he came to Galilee, he was endued with the power of the Spirit, and that was a capital S Spirit also. So Jesus is now telling them and reading, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel." Anointed, we know that anointing was done when someone was set aside. We know that when the prophet Samuel came, the prophet Samuel, he went anointed Saul, the first king of Israel, and he also anointed David, the second king of Israel, because God had selected David. So, and the Samuel anointed, meaning that he was then set aside that he would have a special purpose. So Jesus is sharing here that he has been anointed to preach the gospel. But preach the gospel to who? Preach the gospel to the poor. The poor have always been overlooked, no matter where it goes, but God cares about everyone. God cares about the poor. God cares about the downtrodden. God cares and desires for us as human beings, as us as mankind, to treat everyone the way God treats, meaning that all lives are precious, that everyone should be respected, but not just the wealthy who can seem to walk around and to stomp on people, but to care about the poor. And Jesus has come, and he's come and has been anointed to preach the gospel. And we know that gospel is good news, to preach the gospel to the poor. The poor are always overlooked, but then God is caring, and God declares and has anointed Jesus to come and preach the gospel to the poor. And by preaching the gospel to the poor, preaching the good news that a Savior is on the way, a Savior is here, that God is going to redeem mankind. Then the next part of chapter eight, of verse 18, it says, he has sent me to heal the broken heart. Jesus declared that He did the will of the Father, and the will of the Father is the one who sent him. And so Jesus is declaring that the Father sent him. And so Jesus is now reading this, and he says, he has sent me. And why did God send Jesus? And what did he send Jesus to do? He sent Jesus to heal the brokenhearted. We have a broken heart because we have sinned and fallen short. We've done many things that's wrong, but Jesus came to give us, to mend our broken heart, to give us to where we can have back the right relationship with God the Father. And Jesus says, he has sent me again. God sent Jesus into the world for a purpose. God sent him to preach the gospel to the poor. God sent him to heal the brokenhearted. And to heal it means to fix it, to heal our broken hearts. And then to preach deliverance to the captives, to preach that, yes, we have been captive. We are captive at that time by sin. But Jesus is going to come and pay a ransom that no man could pay, that whatever sin was holding on to us, that no longer will be held on to us. Let me try to make that a little plainer. Sin, when sin came into the world, so did death. Death and separation came into the world when sin came in. And so we have all been captive, meaning held down by sin, because the wages of sin is death. But when Jesus came, Jesus is coming and he's going to pay that ransom where we are not captive by sin anymore. The wages of sin is death, but the death and those wages have been paid by the Messiah, will be paid by the Christ, will be paid by Jesus Christ. And so all the things that sin was able to hold on and to hold us down, Jesus is going to come and to buy back, purchase back for us what we had lost. And so he came to preach the deliverance to the captive, that we will be delivered. We will be redeemed from what was holding us down. And so Jesus came and he's preaching that, and he did that, and he's going to do that. And so then the next part, and Jesus is reading, and he's reading what the prophet Isaiah said, and recovering of sight to the blind. Recovering of sight. That means to bring back sight, where we can be able to see, to give sight back, to restore sight for people. And Jesus, we know that he did that because many people who were blind, Jesus opened up blinded eyes, even eyes of a man that was born blind. Jesus performed that miracle because the disciples asked the question, who sinned, this man who was born blind or his parents? And that made their child to be born blind. But Jesus declared no one sinned. This man was born blind so that God could be glorified, so that Jesus could fulfill the scriptures that says for the recovering of sight to the blind. So this man, even though he had never seen before, he was able to have his vision recovered and restored, where he would then be able to see. We also know about the man who was on the side of the road, blind Bartimaeus, who was crying out, O son of David. And they said that he came to them, what would you have? He said that he would like that he would be able to get his sight back. And the Lord spat on the ground and took some mud and anointed his eyes. Didn't take the mud and place it on his eyes, but anointing. Because when we use the word anointing, that is set aside. That is something special. That is something from God. And so Jesus anointed his eyes, and he was then able to see. Again, fulfilling the scriptures that had been prophesied, and Jesus came and performed those miracles as the scripture had declared that the Messiah would do. Or the Christ. Now, the Messiah Christ means the same thing. And then the latter part of verse 18 says, to set at liberty them that are bruised. And the set at liberty, meaning to provide freedom for those who have been bruised, who have been oppressed, those have been held down. Jesus is coming and he's going to preach a liberty of a freedom that we can be able to go back to God the Father. We will not have to go and stand in a line. We'll be able to go to God ourselves because Jesus has paid the ransom. Jesus has made it where we can go back to God ourselves. And that is where he says, set at liberty, which is the freedom for them that are bruised, where God is going to come and to take care of us. So Jesus is now reading, and he's read verse 18. And now when we look at verse 19, Jesus is reading to the people there that are in the synagogue, and he's reading what the prophet had said. And then in verse 19, he says, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. The acceptable year of the Lord, that's talking about the Messiah. That's talking about the Messiah age, or talking about the age of the Messiah and of the year of Jubilee. The Jewish people, they knew about Jubilee. Now, whether or not everyone was participating or would do it, but God had given them the commandment that says that every 7 years, 6 years you work, and then the seventh year you don't plant. Whatever grows, just let it grow, but don't harvest it. And then he said, and then that's 7 years. And then Jesus and God gave them about 7 times 7, which is 49th year and the 50th year. The 50th year would be the year of Jubilee, where God said that if anyone who has sold things away, have lost things, but in the year of Jubilee, everything reverts back to the family. If you sold things and you had lost it, or someone had done some things and had misappropriated land and things like that, the family would not lose that land forever. Because in the year of Jubilee, everything goes back to the way it was. And see, Jesus is coming here in verse number 19 to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And the year of Jubilee means that that's a time of restoration, a time where things are brought back to the way that it once was. Jesus is preaching that man, if we go back, Adam was there in the garden and he communed with man. Adam communed with God. God communed with man. But when sin came in, then we lost that. There was a separation. But Jesus is declaring here, he's going to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And just like when we talk about the Jubilee, what we had lost, we lost so many things. But because of Jesus' sacrificial death, because God accepted that, what we had lost, we now have access back to. The deed that we had lost as far as what mankind had, it was lost, but Jesus came and purchased it back. He came and brought it back, purchased it back as our kinsman redeemer. So what we had lost, we no longer have lost, because we now have the right to go to God. We can pray to God and have access to God ourselves through his son, Jesus Christ. So Jesus came to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Verse number 20. Now Jesus is reading from the prophet Isaiah. He's reading to the people there in the synagogue, and he's read these words. Verse 20. After he finished that, he closed the book and he gave it again to the minister. The minister is the attendant, the person who gave him the scroll. He gave the book of the prophet Isaiah back to the minister. And then he sat down. And that was their method of teaching. Yes, here we stand and teach, but at that time people would sit down and teach. And Jesus had said, and it says that, and he gave it again to the minister and sat down. He sat down ready to teach. And verse number two, the latter part of verse 20 says, and the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. That means that everyone that was in the synagogue, their eyes were on Jesus. Jesus had their attention. So they are there looking at Jesus and wondering how he's going to expound upon what the prophet had said. How is he going to talk about it? How is he going to teach about this? Remember, Jesus has the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost full spirit power, capital S power, is on him. And Jesus has read the words, and the people's eyes are fastened on him so that they can hear. He has their attention, and now he's going to teach them about what the prophet had said. And we look at verse number 21 and 22. Verse 21 says, and he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. And all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? Verse 21. They all are looking at Jesus. They are wondering, how is he going to expound upon this? What is he going to say? He has read from the book of Isaiah. He has read that about the acceptable year of the Lord coming. He has read about that he has been anointed to preach the gospel. So they wondering, how's he going to expound upon it? And verse 21 says, and he began to say. Now this began, we know, is just the beginning, isn't it? We know that we can begin a journey. That's the first part of anything. And what it says, and he began to say to them, meaning that he said other things after this. He taught them after this. But notice the things that he started off with saying. He has read these words to them, and then the Lord said, this day. Not another day, not sometime in the past, not sometime in the future, but on this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. You all came to church today and you came to the synagogue today and you have heard Jesus read these words, and then Jesus said that this scripture, the prophecy of Isaiah, had been many, many years ago. 700 and some years ago, but Jesus said, this day is this scripture fulfilled. This scripture is fulfilled in your ears. You have heard and you will hear the things that the prophet had said would come true. That the prophet had said that the gospel would be preached to the poor. The prophet had said that he would send someone to heal the brokenhearted. And Jesus is declaring that this day, this scripture has been fulfilled in your ears. And he began with that. And then he went on and started expounding upon it to share with them about what God's word is. And so after telling them that it was fulfilled in their ears and they heard it, he continued on with the teachings. And then verse 22 says, and all, that does not leave anyone out. All the people that were there in the synagogue and all bear him witness, meaning they all heard it, they all were there and able to witness to it, and they wondered at the gracious words. There's something about the words that Jesus is using, the power in which he's teaching, the power in which he is sharing the word, and the way that he is expounding upon it, that God is there teaching his people his words. And so God the Son is there teaching the people what God the Father had told the prophet to say, and God the Son is teaching the people, and the people are listening to those gracious words that proceeded out of his mouth. They're listening. Some would say they're hanging on every word that he is sharing. And so they're listening and they're wondering, and so much so that they then ask a question. And they asked the question and they said, is not this Joseph's son? They're listening to him. They're listening to what he has said, that this scripture had been fulfilled in their ears. And then they ask the question, is this not Joseph's son? Because they are only looking at the earthly side. But he is God's son, because it had been prophesied what would happen. But they are just looking and they start to wonder, is this Joseph's son? How can he have these words? How can he have this teaching? How can he do this? Because Joseph was a carpenter, and we understand that Jesus was a carpenter, but he is on Joseph's side. He learned the trade of carpentry. Well, not learned, but because God knows everything. But Jesus was raised as a carpenter. But they're looking and saying, is this not Joseph's son? But Jesus is God's son. And so they are only looking at one side of it. And so they're asking that question, who is he? How is he able to teach? How is he sharing this? And so, but they're listening to these gracious words. Now we understand and we know that as we continue on with chapter 4, they got to the point that when Jesus was continued to teach, that they wanted to throw him headlong out the city. And that means throw him off of a cliff. And Jesus, you know, because it was shared that a prophet is not welcome, you know, in their own hometown. But Jesus there in Nazareth, they're asking the question about, is he Joseph's son? Because they know him. They saw him grow up, but they are only looking with physical eyes as opposed to looking at it with spiritual eyes. The title of the lesson is Called to Proclaim. God, when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and shared with Mary that she was highly favored among women, and then when the Holy Ghost overshadowed Mary because Mary said, behold, the handmaid of God, that the Messiah would come into the world. And so Mary did her part by allowing the Holy Spirit to overshadow her, and Jesus being the Messiah, being the one who is God's son, being called Emmanuel, God in the flesh, that he came and he is came and he came and he is called to proclaim. To proclaim means to announce, to proclaim. And that is what Jesus has done and is doing. He is proclaiming the word of God. He is proclaiming and fulfilling all of the scriptures. Jesus came to not to destroy the prophecies, but to fulfill them. And that is what he did. He came to fulfill all of the scriptures. So the title of the lesson again is Called to Proclaim. And that is what our Lord and Savior did. He came and proclaimed the word. He came and preached the word. And he fulfilled all of the scriptures as had been promise that the Messiah would do. The Messiah and the Christ would come and fulfill all of the prophecies. And that is what our Lord and Savior did, and that is what he continues to do, to proclaim the word and to came and fulfilled all of the prophecies. Amen. We thank you so much for tuning in. We thank you so much for your participation. We certainly appreciate all of the members that have been using the push pay and delivering their tithes and offerings here. The deacons will be here from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock. The Pastor Jones sermon will start at 11 a.m. And again, we thank you so much for being a part of this ministry. And we also trust that when we know that hearts are being changed, for we have members that have called, we've taken on new members, even during this absentee time, this COVID-19 time that's going on now, God is still opening hearts. God is still touching souls and letting people know that they need to get right. And many are accepting our Lord and Savior as their personal Savior, and they then are also becoming a part of God's army. We know that all we can do is what we do, which is try to get the word out, but we know that God is the one that gives all of the increase, and to him be all the glory and all the praises forever and ever. Amen. Thank you so much again. May we pray. Our Father in heaven, God, we thank you. Lord, we trust that anything that was said that was correct, God, we give you all the credit and all the honor. For Lord, we are just human vessels, and Lord, we can't remember anything, but God, we know that you know everything. And God, we count it a privilege that you would choose to work within us, and Lord, to help us to share your word throughout all of the people out there on the airways and to use technology to try to get the word out. Because God, we know that we're living in the last days, and God, we're trusting and knowing that you are God all by yourself. God, thank you so much for allowing us to be able to be safe. God, we also thank you so much for touching man's brains that we have a few vaccines out, and God, help the vaccines to be shared rightly with everyone. And God, we are trusting and knowing that you are able to do anything but fail. God, this and many other blessings we ask in your Son, Jesus the Christ's name. Amen. Thank you so much for tuning in as we go to end this. We really appreciate all of the participation. Thank you again, and may God bless you.